Have you put your data to work? This is another video from Brockhaus Applied Data Intelligence. This time we're going to talk about risk assessment. Risk assessment is becoming more and more important in contamination control and clean room technology. Today I want to have a look at the use of risk assessment for a product. But we first start with having a look at risk. A risk is the probability of a threat, injury, liability, loss of quality, or any other negative occurrence that can be caused by internal or external vulnerabilities that could be avoided by a preemptive action. So risk is the product of consequences and probability of a harm or a hazardous event or phenomenon. To illustrate this this product of consequences and probability, I made an example of somebody walking a tree trunk. When you walk a tree trunk, you can balance a little bit. It's quite easy. The chance that you fall off is not too big, and the consequences are also not too big, as long as this tree trunk is just above shallow water. It becomes a difference when you have a guard and you put a tree over it and you want to cross it, because you know that when you fall down, you won't survive it. So the consequences are severe. But still, the probability of falling is relatively small. This will change when you start walking a rope, because the chance that you fall down from a rope is much larger. And when you put a rope over a guard or any other height, then a fall could lead to death. So in this case, severity is high and probability is high. Of course, you can take measures by putting a safety rope or guidance ropes, so that you can reduce the probability of falling. So I hope that's a bit clear now. I put a small graph where you can see the consequences and severity, the consequences, the severity of consequences, and the likelihood of that happening. And when the product is high, you come into the red area, the high risk area. When the product is green, you are in the low risk area. So when we look at contamination risk, we can use what we have learned about risk, but then for contamination. So it is the probability or threat of damage, loss, drop of quality, or any other negative occurrence caused by unwanted contamination that could be avoided by a good contamination control action. A contamination risk is in fact the consequences of contamination and the probability of contamination of unwanted contaminants. This could be particles, chemicals, microorganisms. The consequences can be scaled according to the different levels of severity. So a product could lose its quality, but you could also have a product which fails, and because it fails, it leads to an accident and to death. So then the severity is much higher. You can also use it for looking at infections, at medical treatments, or contamination of food. Risk assessment. We talked about risk, but now we want to look at the action of assessing a risk. And the definition of risk assessment is the identification, evaluation, and estimation of the levels of risk involved in a situation in comparison to benchmarks, standards, and the determination of the level of risk. A risk assessment consists of identification of hazards or harms, looking at exposure of your product, process, patient, and characterize the risk. A risk always starts with a creative process, with a team which you perform your risk assessment to identify potential harms, potential hazards. And when you have a list of potential hazards, that's when you're going to look at it, okay, what are the consequences of such a hazard and what is the likelihood it can happen, and later on, what can I do to prevent it? So the result of a risk assessment can be used to look at control solutions, contamination control solutions to reduce the probability. So when we do a risk assessment, we look at a number of questions. The first question is, what is the function of this product and what would threaten this function, and what type of quality issues or levels of severity can I identify. Then the second thing is, you have to find out what are critical services inside my product. And then later we're going to look at the locations where these critical services are exposed to the environment. And then we would also like to figure out what is the unwanted contaminant. Are it particles, or microorganisms, or chemicals, or a combination of those? And then we could try to quantify it. Are you sensitive for particles larger than 100 micrometers, or 50, or 10 micrometers? Are you sensitive for a certain type of microorganism, and so on? So you determine the type, the size, and the amount of contaminants which you can accept and which you cannot accept anymore. And when you have done that, you can quantify that in terms of surface cleanliness levels, which we discussed before. So the result of a risk assessment in the first phase is an overview of critical services of the product, critical contaminants, and critical amounts of contaminants, and also the acceptable level of contamination. Because you have to learn a little bit what is acceptable and what is not acceptable, because the less you accept, the more difficult it will be to make your product. So you have to find the right balance there. And this type of information you can use to determine the final surface cleanliness of your product. This you can use later to determine what your initial surface cleanliness should be before you start your processing. That one should be better. And the difference between those two is your latitude when you perform your process. Let's have a simple example, like a camera. A camera has a number of functions. The goal is to make a nice picture, which is sharp, it's not moved, you don't lose parts, and so on. So when you look at the functions inside the parts inside the camera, then you can identify mechanical parts like a shutter, focusing system, and so on. So when that doesn't function, a picture cannot take, or the settings are completely wrong. Then you have an optical system, which transfers the optical image onto a sensor. When there is dirt on the optical system, you see it as points in a photograph, or it is blurred. So that's also not good. And then the third function is your sensor that transfers the optical image into electrical image, and with your software that is transferred into a digital image. So we have, although a camera is very complicated, you can identify three major parts: the mechanics, the optics, and the sensing part. Then you can you try to find out what type of contamination you accept at each part and what do you not accept. We can imagine that for mechanical parts, when we look at particle contamination, they can be a little bit larger compared to when you look at a sensor, where you really have sensitive areas of a few micrometers. There you are, of course, also more sensitive for smaller particles. So I'm not going into numbers. I've written papers and there I explain this example also in numbers. So the thing is that when you have done this step, we know what are our vulnerable areas inside our product, and now we're going to look at how we are making our product, because when we make a product, different parts come together, they are assembled, so it's important to know how clean are the parts which come in, where are the critical surfaces exposed to the environment, because when it's exposed, particles can fall on it, or tools which are also exposed can transfer particles onto these parts. And this vulnerable locations you can put in your process flow, and once you have made your process flow, you can also put that on the, you can map it on the layout of your factory which you have or which you are planning to make. So when we look at the camera, then you can say, okay, I have the different parts which come in for the optics and for my camera body. Those I'm going to put together. Then later the mechanics will be assembled. That will probably be another location. Then another part of the camera body will contain the sensor elements and the electronics, and that will be put together. So you can see you have different locations where you put different vulnerable parts together. So there where those vulnerable parts are exposed, you look at what you have to do to prevent contamination. And that type of information you transfer to your facility, and there you can then say something about surface cleanliness, air cleanliness, and deposition rates. So once you have made your process flow, you can, and you have a map of your facility or the plan you have to for the facility you're going to make, you put your process flow there and you identify the critical places. It's also interesting then to look at movement of people, because people are a very important source of contamination. So then you also know where people come in the neighborhood of your vulnerable product, so that you know that you have to take extra measures at those locations. Later on, I'll also explain a little bit how you can prioritize the different types of risk you have in the process. And this risk is in fact determined again by occurrence and severity. Severity is depends on the design of your product, and probability on the way you are manufacturing it. So with contamination control, the only factor we can influence is the probability, the occurrence. Thank you for your attention. In the next part, we are going to look a little bit more into detail at the contamination mechanisms and cleanliness elements.